So hi everyone, James Wilson, as Joe mentioned earlier, super excited to show you Weave GitOps Enterprise and the new features, pipelines, GitOps templates, and GitOps sets. So what you see here is the Weave GitOps Enterprise dashboard, right? And this is your central hub for managing everything from your platform, where you can configure clusters, create and update templates, work with GitOps sets, deliver infrastructure with Terraform and our Terraform controller, or deliver secrets, as well as delivery with a focus on delivering applications and up-leveling it to progressive delivery, where you could do canary and blue-green rollouts, to guardrails when you're putting your teams, having your teams in workspaces where they can safely work on the same cluster together, along with policies, everything from cluster policies to application policies and infrastructure policies, and making it super easy to configure those. But today we're going to focus on three specific areas. And the first area I want to talk about is pipelines. And so you could see here that I'm already on the pipelines list view, and I have a pipeline here on the system. And now when we went to go and create pipelines, there was a particular problem that we wanted to solve, right? And so, you know, your context on your CI system has just one piece, right? And that is the code that you've written and that you are now pushing to your container registry or wherever else you're maintaining your binaries, right? And then you have the other side where you've delivered that code to someplace, whether it's on Kubernetes or some other managed application service, right? And a lot of times those two things can't talk. And even with Flux, which is incredibly powerful, when you go to build that type of system on your own, it's a lot of work. Believe me, we tried it. We tried not to build this feature, and it was just too painful of an experience. So we knew we had to tackle it. And so our pipeline system was really meant to tie all of that context together, right? We want to tie it to your Git repositories alongside knowing how it's being deployed across clusters. And so we built a new pipeline controller and CRD that does just that. And something we wanted to be very mindful of too, as we developed this, was that you can bring your own CI system and your Git service, right? You don't have to migrate off GitHub Actions or Circle CI or Jenkins if you're using that. And you can use GitHub, GitLab, Bitbucket, right? We support all the major Git providers as well. And so keep that in mind as I'm going through this product. Now, here you can see the pipeline listed here, and it defines three separate environments: dev, staging, and production. And And so when I go and click on that after I log in again, that I am taken to a detail screen, which shows me all of the information and context that I need about this particular application deployment, right? I know that dev version 1.36, I know that the dev environment's on version 1.36 with this number right here, and that staging and production are on the prior version, version 1.35, right? I know that this is a fully automated pipeline and that it's using a pull request strategy, which means it's going to be opening pull requests for me on my behalf, and the exact repo that it's interacting with. Now, what happens here? Well, as I go and update and push a new version to dev, what's going to happen is the pipeline controller will go see that that pull request was merged, and it's going to go ahead and update dev. And once dev is green and we get that green check mark, it's going to go ahead and automatically open a pull request for the staging environment. And it's going to go ahead and update the YAML. And now my team can go ahead and through its normal Git processes, go review the pull request and merge it. And now that's going to be marked green. And then it's going to open a pull request for production. And so you can do whatever compliance things you need to take care of in order to deploy it to production. And then you can merge that pull request and boom, it'll land on production. And what this meant to do is really just take the thought process out of it, right? It's automating a lot of different things. It's updating various pieces of YAML, and all the application developers need to focus on is really just reviewing it. Yes, that's the correct version I want deployed. and hitting merge pull request, and all the rest of the work is done for you. And now something that's really nice about this is, right, this is all declarative and saved in Git, can be saved in Git as well. And so here's a pipeline CRD that you were just looking at. And you can see here that we can define which environments that it's a part of. And you can define also the clusters that it's associated with. So you can deploy to multiple clusters, as well as the promotion strategy. And so here we have it set to automatic, but you could also set it to manual, right? A lot of people want that good feeling of being able to push a button directly from the UI to kick off the next phase of the process. And we provide that capability as well. And so one of the nice features about this too, though, is, you know, in this particular one, we're using the notification strategy. And there's a good bit of YAML you need to write to fully set that up and everything. Well, Weave GitOps Enterprise ships with pre-built templates for working with the pipeline system. And if you need something completely custom, you can go and build it yourself. But you can see here that we had created this with the GitOps templating system because I have this edit button here. And so if I come to edit pipeline, it's going and pulling up the template that I used, and it's going to pre-populate the fields with all the data that I'd already inputted for this pipeline. Now, why is this beneficial? Well, number one, you can go and create templates for anything. As long as it's a Kubernetes resource, you can go ahead and do it. Why did we build it this way? Well, you know, a lot of times when you get into that YAML, or if you abstract things away with a Helm chart, it can get very cumbersome to kind of keep context and know what fields need to be updated, which ones don't, which ones shouldn't be touched. And so with this, platform operators, or anyone for that matter, can easily define the values that you want to be editable. And you have a lot of unique fields, right? You can just do text fields. Here I have a drop-down menu where I have two predefined values that the user can select. And so it gives you that extra fine-grained control. And when they're done creating this template or updating it, right, they can go ahead with whatever Git provider they're using via Weave GitOps Enterprise. In this case, we're using GitHub. And this will go and automatically open a PR and update that YAML for you. But just to give you some context, right, I'm going to hit the preview PR button here, and it's going to go and show you all of the YAML under the hood that this particular template is generating, right? And so here I have a namespace YAML, I have a customization, I have a flux provider and alert, I have more namespaces and customizations, right? And so the platform operator had already set up the appropriate labels for all of those things. There's a lot of information that's baked under the hood here, with only specific items from here being able to, that can be edited. Now, something I want to do is, right, I want to come to the template screen here. I'm not going to change the pipeline system right now. And you can see, even on this sample environment, all the different types of templates we've created here. So I have different types like cluster, secret, application, pipeline. And I'm going to come down to a RDS template here, which is for creating a sample of our RDS template on AWS. And so I'll come here, use this template, and you can see that I have various empty fields here. And once I go and fill all of these in, I can then go ahead and open that pull request. And once it merges, the Terraform controller will go and deploy a new Aurora database for me. And now coming back over here, here is that same template, and here's the YAML on how it was made, right? And so I have a GitOps template, and then here I'm just defining the parameters that I care about, right? And these parameters are the ones that will appear on the user interface. And then these values are then injected into this resource template below. And so you can see here that I just have a Terraform object, and I'm going ahead and putting those user inputted values into this particular Terraform object. And then the Terraform controller will be able to pick that up and deploy it. Now, one thing that we've also done as well is with our VS Code extension, we have created this UI experience from our GitOps VS Code extension. And so we wanted to get closer to developers so they don't even need to log into Weave GitOps Enterprise, right? As long as they have access to the templating system, they or particular templates, they can go and use it directly from VS Code, fill it in, it will create the YAML on their local working directory, and then they can go and push those changes and open a pull request and merge them. And so it's a really nice workflow that it gets just closer to the developer. And now one final thing I want to touch on this before transitioning over to GitOps Sets is that this is all RBAC controlled as well, right? You have the ability, because these are Kubernetes resources, to be able to control what teams have access to which templates. You know, so if you have a certain set that are really only for application deployments, they can go ahead, you can go ahead and make sure the application teams get access to those. If there are some critical infrastructure templates that you only want one particular team to have access to, you can control that via RBAC. And so this introduces a lot of fine-grained control in terms of how it works. Now, this is awesome, right? And one of the things when I showed with the pipeline system was just the number of YAML objects that were created just to get that one piece of functionality working, right? It can be a lot, and we've all been there, right? Kind of creating YAML after YAML, and it just feels chaotic. And we're, quite frankly, I can speak from my own personal experience, I can go cross-eyed with the amount of YAML that I can write sometimes. And so we really want to solve that problem. And that's why we're introducing GitOps Sets as well. Now, what does GitOps Sets do? It's a way to use data to dynamically drive the configuration of your clusters. And so what do I mean by that? Well, let's use a simple example here. So here I have a GitOps set, and I have a generator that's called a list generator. And all it does, it lets me just produce a list of items that I care about with unique values. And so here I have just a field called name. And then below that, I have a template for namespace. And I'm injecting this name variable down into this namespace. And so what's the GitOps controller going to do for me? Well, it's going to create five namespace objects for me, and it's going to inject each one of these into that each one of those objects. And so what's nice is if I need to create a new namespace, instead of creating a whole new namespace YAML object, a new YAML file, I can just go and append to this list, and then it will dynamically add new ones. And if I want to get rid of these two, I can go ahead and delete it. And when I push and merge to my cluster, it will go ahead and delete those. And now this is a really basic example, right? We have a ton of different generators that you can use and configure, right? We have an API generator, which lets you hit an API endpoint, and you can then inject that data into your configuration. And so here's a GitOps set where we're getting the weather from Berlin, and then we're injecting the color of that into this application. It will change the application background based on the weather in Berlin, you know, or you could get more serious, right? Here's one with a pull request generator. Now, what's this one doing? It's going to your Git repository and it's seeing what open pull requests there are. And then you can take that pull request data and inject it into objects below. And in this instance, what we're doing is we're injecting it into Flux objects to create ephemeral preview environments that code reviewers and quality engineers can use on a day-to-day workflow. And so if I come to GitOps Sets in our dashboard and come to the pull request pod info, I can see here that I have workloads based on open pull requests on my Git repository. And then even further, leveraging our metadata system, I can go and append custom metadata onto each of these workflows. And in this particular instance, I have the app URL here for the deployed microservice. And so if I was a quality engineer, I could go ahead and click on it. I can go ahead, use the service or the new application, verify the changes are good, and then approve the pull request. And when that pull request is finally merged or closed, this pull request generator will automatically clean up these pull request environments. And then when the next one opens up, it will go ahead and deploy that. And so you can start to see here how powerful and flexible these can really be. Going back to the API generator, maybe you have some MySQL data, you know, some data on a database somewhere on your cloud provider, and you just create a cloud function endpoint, right? You can go ahead, use the API generator to hit that endpoint and then inject that data to configure your cluster. And now one final piece is, right, we are the company that created Flux. We have a lot of expertise in that area. And as we're building all of these controllers, we are learning and taking those lessons learned from building those Flux controllers and making sure that we put all of those same features and security into these new controllers. And now that earlier example I showed you of the namespace GitOps set, well, here I went ahead and tried to deploy it, but I wasn't allowed to. And that's because the service account that's driving the GitOps sets controller does not have the permission to just go ahead and create any object, right? And in this particular instance, it does not have privileges to deploy namespaces. And so it blocked it and it didn't allow them to be deployed. And you can add even extra layers of security by leveraging our policy system and tying policies to these GitOps sets as well. And so again, just really flexible, trusted application delivery. So that was a very fast overview of pipelines, templates, and GitOps sets. I really hope you enjoyed it. The team is super excited to keep building these out. We have a lot of new ideas for generators for GitOps sets. And thank you. Joe?